Hi friends, we're here to talk about Vanity Fair from pages, well really the whole novel, but especially 300 to 400. So we're about halfway through now. And the section we've just finished reading is basically the section on the Battle of Waterloo. Mm-hmm. We don't get to see the battlefield itself, but we get to see what's going on behind the scenes back at the hotel in Brussels. Mm-hmm. I was just looking up a little bit of information about the battle because, you know, it's like one of those historical events that you maybe hear about, but you really don't know the details. And I mean, I know it's a big battle, but I guess because they went into it kind of cavalierly, like, mm-hmm. oh, we're just going to go to Brussels and hang out and have a good time.
Great clothes in Brussels.
I don't know. I didn't really take the battle that seriously, but so I just looked it up. This is just on Wikipedia. On the Allied side, the casualties and losses were about 23,000 to 24,000 in the British Army, and 7,000 in the Prussian army. And on the French side, 41,000 to 42,000. So first of all, that's all basically in what, 1 or 2 days? I mean, yeah. That's a horrible, horrible number of casualties in such a short time. And it's really striking too that we were noticing on the French side, 15,000 men missing. That kind of put in perspective for me how bad that battle really was. Because I don't think that really comes across in the novel.
No, I mean, it comes across a little bit through Joss, actually, who's a coward. There's no getting around it with him.
Right.
But, I mean, he does seem to understand that this is going to be an awful event and does try to get out of it.
Yeah. And, of course, Becky is like, oh, you're such a coward. We're not going right. anywhere. At some point, somebody comes to report back to them that Captain Osborne was responsible for killing the Frenchman who stuck a spear through one of the boys on the mm-hmm. battlefield that Dobbin then picks up and rescues. Uh-huh. And then they report that the fighting is done and Captain Osborne is safe.
Right, several of them are reported safe and it's in a sequence and so you kind of feel like, oh, this is going to work out okay.
Right. It's Dobbin who promised the driver two louis if he would make his way to Mr. Sedley's hotel in the city and tell Mrs. Captain Osborne, Amelia, that the action was over and that her husband was unhurt and well.
Yeah.
And I took that at face value. And then we get the rest of the, you know, the chapter goes on for several more pages. At the very end of the chapter, we're not even really thinking about it anymore. Suddenly it says, no more firing was heard at Brussels. The pursuit rolled miles away. Darkness came down on the field and city and Amelia was praying for George, who was lying on his face, dead, with a bullet through his heart. I actually gasped out loud when I read that. And so then I was thinking, wait, what did Thackeray do to set me up like that?
Right.
But it's because we were actually told he was safe.
Mm-hmm.
And
but this is one of the moments where I really liked the narrator. I felt like this is a moment where I've been set up in a good way. I haven't been manipulated in a negative
way. Right, because we felt more manipulated earlier, finding out that Becky was married.
Right. Right.
Yeah, and this wasn't the same kind of manipulation.
No.
I don't know why, though, because he did say that he was safe, and he wasn't safe.
Right, but I mean, just kind of expect war to be chaotic, you know?
And
I mean, one of the really interesting things is they go to war, and we don't really see much war. We hear reports. Yeah. I mean, it's still a social novel, a novel about gossip, and then here's this moment of just reality.
Right.
And I love the way the sentence is written, George, who is lying on his face, dead, with a bullet through his heart. Yeah. Like the rhythm, the cadence, and just that final getting it to land on heart is really a great moment.
And the fact that he's lying on his face, like there's something so
ignoble.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right, about that.
George is, you know, he's kind of a lousy guy. And so, you know, I mean, there's some sort of justification that he gets it through the heart because he's been heartless and blah 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 blah, but it's also a moment where you're kind of like, oh wow,
yeah, this is for
and
real.
And I kind of feel a moment of a little bit of sympathy. That's excessive punishment.
Well, sympathy for sure for Amelia, because you know this is going to be devastating for her.
Yeah.
So again, Becky comes out ahead. Like, first of all, Rawdon survives the battle. But second of all, if anything had happened to Rawdon, you sort of get the impression that, you know, Becky might feel bad about it. But they've already had this whole conversation about if he dies, how much all his stuff is worth. And they have it cataloged. He seems to be genuinely concerned for her well-being should something happen to him. Mm-hmm. She seems to be just very methodical and practical about it
all. But I love that image of her sewing the jewels into her clothing. Yeah. Which, I mean, other people did it, but for Becky, it really seems like just like clutching, you know, in the way that she does.
Not just jewels, but anything that was worth anything, she sews. And then there's a scene where later on she's at a tavern or something, I forget, but in front of the major, Trotto, I think his name is, who really admires her, and she's basically like pulling all of the trinkets out of her dress and presenting them, you know, making a show of it as she is wont to do. So this whole section is kind of covering the battle. And then we wanted to talk a little bit again about the narrator. I don't know, like at times we felt is too much imposing himself on the story and at other times manipulating us. And there's a reference in here to the fact that this is a historical novel that's written several decades after the action occurs. He says something about, you know, those who are our age are looking back. And so he's kind of positioning himself as a contemporary with his audience.
Well, the narrator does intrude in a couple places to editorialize about Vanity Fair and those themes and, you know, what he thinks of different characters. But on the other hand, I also felt like this was a section where he just kind of let it roll and let characters do their things. And, you know, there was definitely some sort of stacking of scenes so that we would compare. So, like, when the couples are getting ready for the war, you have, like, Mrs. O'Dowd. Like, she knows how to get ready for war.
Yeah.
You know?
Right, she's done it before.
Right, and then Becky and Rawdon, they, like, sort of know. And then, like, Amelia and George have no clue what to do.
Yeah.
And so there is that sort of structuring of the narrative going on. But on the other hand, the narrator doesn't seem so aggressive,
He doesn't step in and really speak for himself.
Yeah.
I mean, so you're really talking more about Thackeray layering up those couples, the way he structured the novel. I think we have to speak of the novel as of the novelist and the narrator as potentially two different characters.
Right.
So, yeah, the narrator, we don't really hear from him very much. But there's one key spot that I wanted to read where he comments on the title or the subtitle of the novel, which is A Novel Without a Hero. And he says something kind of coy about Becky here. So this is that scene, actually, where Becky and Rawdon are going over their valuables. Among the notes in Rawdon's pocketbook was a draft for £20 on Osborne's banker, because George owes Rawdon money gambling from a gambling debt. This made her think about Mrs. Osborne. "I will go and get the draft cashed," she said, "and pay a visit afterwards to poor little Emmy." And then the narrator steps in. "If this is a novel without a hero, at least let us lay claim to a heroine." And I thought, oh, very sneaky. Okay, so it isn't really a novel without a hero. "No man in the British army which has marched away, not the great Duke himself, could be more cool or collected in the presence of doubts and difficulties than the indomitable little aide-de-camp's wife," meaning Becky. Well, I mean, we're basically being told outright that she's the heroine of the novel. We talked earlier about this subtitle, A Novel Without a Hero, and I think we were assuming that that was an ungendered term. He's letting her slip around that.
Right, and it's interesting because, I mean, if she's the heroine of the novel, it's an interesting value system.
Well, it's Vanity Fair.
Right? So is she the hero of the vanity, or is she somehow the heroine of something outside that, something like good and just and things like that?
Right. I mean, I guess it's possible to read it either way.
I don't see how she's going to jump to the world of the good and the just.
No, and also it very clearly is letting us know that Dobbin is not, I mean, even though we have a soft spot for Dobbin, he is not going to be this is a novel without a hero.
No, he's just going to keep getting freight trained.
Yeah. You've been reading and listening.
I've had to do a lot of driving lately, and it's been fabulous. This book just plays so well.
That's really
interesting. As an audiobook. Yeah.
Why?
There's something engrossing about the story, but it's also, you can drive on the highway without being dangerous, right? So there's a good
balance. It's not hard to follow. It's not complicated. Is that what you, I mean?
That's some of it, but I think it's also, I think I'm listening to a LibriVox recording, and the woman who reads it is just really good at getting her independent and dependent clauses and all that 19th century writing clear. I find myself that even though the ideas and sentences are long, because she's a good reader, they're easy to hang on to.
Yeah, that's interesting. Helen Taylor, I think is her name, because another friend who's reading with us mentioned her as a great reader, and the reason she said she liked her was because she does all the voices, mm-hmm. but she doesn't over-dramatize them. She just right. keeps it straight, so when you're listening, you understand who's speaking.
Right, you cue in, but you're not being sort of overly
dramatic reading.
Yeah. Could be also that this is coming out of a tradition of like fireside poetry and things like that, where, you know, Thackeray is writing this for an audience that's not entirely literate, right?
And well, so it's maybe serialized, so right. you could get your copy of whatever publication it was originally published in, share it with the family.
I think Scarlet Letter is a fabulous book, right? And I know that the average copy of Scarlet Letter back in 1851 was read by about 7 different people, right? Books were passed around. And so this idea of this being difficult literature is a little bit off. I mean, we think of it as highbrow or something like that, but really this was commonplace, average reading back then. And I think that that may be partly why it's a good audiobook. It's kind of closer to an oral tradition than, say, like high literary fiction today might be.
Yeah.
But it is interesting. If I lose track for a minute, I really do lose track.
Speaking of losing track, I had to finally make a family tree for the Crawleys because I just couldn't keep it straight anymore. And it's confusing because there are 2 Pitts, mm-hmm. father and the son. But I finally wrote it out, and I'm going to leave a version of it in the comment section below so that anybody else who's struggling with this issue will have this little diagram. It's a pretty simple family tree, but just to get the names straight and to lay it out was really helpful. I guess that's it for page 400. As I said, we're about halfway through the novel, so we're going to keep going, and we will be back when we hit page 500 or so to talk a little bit more about Vanity Fair.